we've got a little over 2.5 hours. Yeah, I've done it before. It just depends on how much time I spend on the forward. So I'm going to try not to spend very much time at all. If you have your books, and I hope you have your books, if you don't, bring them in the future, open with a foreword to the second edition, where Tolkien tells us how the Lord of the Rings came to be. He mentions that he'd actually begun it before the publication of The Hobbit, and then kind of stopped, and turned to what he calls kind of the Tales of the Elder Days. That gets later published as The Silmarillion. His friends tell him, give it up, nobody's going to want to read that stuff, and so he goes back to The Lord of the Rings. And so he essentially works on Lord of the Rings from about 1938 until it's published in 1954. The first volume is published in 1954. The Hobbit comes out in 1937. As I said the other day, when it comes out, it's immediately hailed as a classic. Okay? So Tolkien starts getting letters from readers who want to know more about hobbits and such. Tolkien's very good friend, C.S. Lewis, writes a science fiction trilogy called Out of the Silent Planet, Perelandra, and That Hideous Strength. In one of those books, I think it's Perelandra, he mentions in a, it's That Hideous Strength, he mentions in a footnote something about Westernessa, okay? And he says something to the effect of, alas, those who would like to learn more about Westernessa must await the publication of much that remains only in the manuscript form of my good friend J.R.R. Tolkien. Well, they don't get any more information. When The Lord of the Rings comes out, it's not about Westernessa, per se. It's not about the men of Westernessa. Though we do hear that Aragorn is descended from the kings of Westernessa. You've got to read the Silmarillion in order to understand that. The Silmarillion wasn't published until 1977, 4 years after Tolkien's death. Okay. Since then, his son, his youngest son, has been publishing everything. He has published literally, I think this is true, literally everything in manuscript form that is about Middle Earth that Tolkien wrote. Okay. He hasn't published everything his father wrote. You could go to the Bodleian Library in Oxford if you have the credentials to get in and, you know, have them bring out the manuscripts. And there's tons of stuff. Tolkien's lectures at Oxford, for example, have not been published. I don't know if people are working on them or not. One of the difficulties, because I worked with Tolkien's manuscript several times, one of the difficulties of Tolkien's manuscript is he writes in very, very small letters. And he often wrote in pencil. And it's very light pencil. I mean, it fades over time. Okay? So, in the foreword, he tells us kind of how the Lord of the Rings came to be. And he says that in writing The Hobbit, some of the material from these older tales kind of crept in with names like Elrond and Gondolin, okay, Gandalf. And that happens even more in The Lord of the Rings. And the ring, which is first announced, let's say, in The Hobbit, becomes the link to the between the Silmarillion, The Hobbit, and The Lord of the Rings. How many of you have read The Hobbit? A few of you, not many. If you read The Hobbit and then read The Lord of the Rings, it's like night and day. I mean, it's a very different atmosphere. The Hobbit is very lighthearted. It's, if you're going to use kind of natural imagery, The Hobbit's like a sunny day, and The Lord of the Rings is like late winter. I mean, The Lord of the Rings is kind of dark. Okay, people are dying left and right. Excuse me, bad things are happening all over. You don't get that feeling in The Hobbit. Okay, in fact, in The Hobbit, Elrond and the elves are kind of light and airy and flighty, and they sing silly songs and do strange stuff. Not the somber, sullen, the weight of the world on our shoulders elves that we get in the Lord of the Rings. Okay? He then goes on and talks about people who have reviewed the books and what they've said about the books and what he thinks of the kinds of books they write. They didn't like his books. That's okay. He doesn't like their books. It's fine. Okay? And then he talks about whether or not the book has an inner meaning. And he says, it's the bottom of Roman numeral 20, 23, as for any inner meaning or message, it has in the intention of the author none. Okay. He has not said there is no inner meaning. What he has said was that as he wrote it, he did not intend any inner meaning. Okay? Notice the distinction? Just because he doesn't intend one doesn't mean there isn't one there. All right? So, he talks about how as he wrote the story, it kind of echoed back to the stories of the Silmarillion and such. But then he starts to talk about the imagined war, the War of the Ring, that is recounted in here, okay, and the real Second World War. Because when it was published in 1954, what a lot of people said was, oh, this is a kind of a fictional account of the Second World War. And the ring is obviously the atomic bomb. Okay? So Tolkien says, the real war does not resemble the legendary war in its process or its conclusion. If it had inspired or directed the development of the legend, then certainly the ring would have been seized and used against Sauron. The ring would not have been destroyed, right? Why did the United States, after all, bring so many German scientists out of Germany into the United States? Why did Wernher von Braun, the mastermind behind the German V-1 and V-2 rockets, become the brains behind putting Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin on the moon? Because he was the brains behind rocket propulsion systems. Okay? So, Tolkien's saying, if the legendary war in here had followed or been inspired by the real war, what would have happened to Mordor? What happened to Germany? Was it destroyed? Was Berlin leveled? No, it was occupied. Okay? So, Sauron would not have been destroyed or annihilated, but enslaved. Barad-dûr would not have been destroyed, but occupied. Saruman, failing to get possession of the ring, would in the confusion and treacheries of the time have found in Mordor the missing links in his own researches into ring lore, and before long he would have made a great ring of his own. Why? Because if the ring is the atomic bomb, well, what happens just 2 years after the United States detonates its two atomic bombs in Japan? Russia detonates an atomic bomb, indicating they're now a nuclear power. Thus, the nuclear arms race begins. Okay? So Tolkien says there are other ways of reading. Other arrangements could be devised according to the taste or views of those who like allegory or tropical reference. And then he says, but I cordially dislike allegory in all its manifestations. Now, what does he mean by allegory? Anybody know? Okay, that's one way of looking at it. Think of allegory as symbols. So, you see this as a symbol. What does it mean? Christianity. Does it ever mean crescent and trying to think of the Islamic flag? Does it ever mean Islam? No. Does it ever mean this, Star of David? No. Completely opposite. Okay? But in allegory, this will always and only mean Christianity. So in one of the great allegories of the English language, Pilgrim's Progress by John Bunyan, written in the 17th century, you have a character named Christian. And he is trying to go from where he lives to the celestial city. And as he makes his way, he falls into various pits and sloughs, like swamps and such. And he meets people. He meets people like vice and despair and sin. Okay. Vice always means vice. Despair always means despair. They're never anything else. Okay. So, Tolkien goes on and says, I much prefer history, true or feigned, with its varied applicability to the thought and experience of readers. Okay? Notice the difference between history and allegory. History is talking about the past, right? Notice he says whether true or feigned, that is, a fictional history or true history. Okay? Doesn't matter which one. Why? Because a reader reads that, and what does the reader do? You have the varied applicability to the thoughts and experience of readers. What does he mean by thoughts and experience? These things. When I talked the first day of class about recovery and cleaning our lenses, okay, what's being suggested here is that each of us brings something to everything we read. What's that something we bring? Okay. Our personal experiences. And nobody, no two people in this room share personal experiences. Because each individual is unique. You might have grown up next door to each other. Okay? You could be members of the same family. You don't have the same experience. I've got 4 siblings. We are 5 very different people. Okay? I've got 4 children. They are 4 radically different individuals. Okay? Tolkien is saying that we each bring our baggage to what we read. We filter and sift what we read kind of through that. So, I think that many confuse applicability with allegory. That is, people read something and they kind of apply what they read to their own lives. They see something that, quote unquote, speaks to them. He says, I think some people confuse applicability with allegory. The one resides in the freedom of the reader, applicability. You apply it according to what you get out of it, what you find important in it, okay? And the other in the purpose domination of the author. That is, in allegory, in real allegory, in true, strict allegory, you don't have any freedom of choice. You don't have any freedom to interpret. The author interprets it for you. The author tells you, this is what it means, stupid. And don't try to read it any other way. You can't read Christian in Pilgrim's Progress as anything other than a Christian. It doesn't work if you try to replace Christian with Jew. The whole thing just falls apart. Or Muslim, or Baha'i, or atheist. Why would an atheist be seeking the celestial city? It doesn't work, okay? So, he doesn't like allegory. So, he doesn't like it when people read The Lord of the Rings and say, ah, the ring, that must be nuclear weapons. No. Paraphrasing Freud, sometimes a ring is just a ring. Sometimes a cigar is just a cigar and not anything else. So, he then goes on and says, but what? An author cannot, of course, remain wholly unaffected by his experience. Just as a reader is not unaffected by his experience, an author is not unaffected by his experience. But the ways in which a story germ, that is, the idea of a story, uses the soil of experience are extremely complex, and attempts to define the process are at best guesses from evidence that is inadequate and ambiguous. That's essentially what he says in the fairy story essay, talking about what are the origins of fairy stories. Don't know, doesn't really matter. Okay? What he's saying here is, does it really matter how I came up with my war imagery? No, it doesn't. Is it important that Tolkien served in World War I?
Yes, it very much is.
Are there images that we know are real images from World War I that find their way into the Lord of the Rings? Yes, there are. When Frodo, Sam, and Gollum, for example, make their way through the Dead Marshes in the next book, make their way through the Dead Marshes, and Frodo and Sam see faces in these pools of water. That's an image from the fields of France in World War I, from the Battle of the Somme. We have multiple written accounts of soldiers talking about trying to move from one trench to another trench. Okay? And they get up out of their trench, there's machine gun fire, they're crawling on their bellies, and they come across a pool. And they see a disembodied head, because the head's been blown off, or the body's been blown out from underneath it by a cannonball. Okay, that's what Frodo and Sam are seeing, because that's what Tolkien saw when he fought in the Battle of the Somme. Right? So he goes on and says, "One has indeed personally to come under the shadow of war to feel fully its oppression." Okay, notice. He doesn't say you have to be in war to understand war. He says you have to be in war to fully understand. Okay? I've never been in the military. I've got friends who have. I've got friends who have been in some serious, you know what, over in Iraq and Afghanistan. Kind of stuff I would never want anybody to. That's what Tolkien's talking about. So he says, "But as the years go by, it seems now often forgotten that to be caught in youth by 1914 was no less hideous an experience than to be involved in 1939 and the following years." And you could up that. You could say, or to be caught in 1964 in the United States to get drafted into Vietnam. Okay? What's he mean? He means to be a 17-year-old in 1914 was no different than to be a 17-year-old in 1939. And to be going off to war to defend your country. Now, notice up until then, he's had fairly complex sentences, fairly long sentences. And then he has this little short zinger, almost right in the middle there. "By 1918, all but one of my close friends were dead." We don't know exactly how many close friends Tolkien had. He was somewhat shy and reserved. So let's say he had 10 close friends. 9 of them were gone. Let's say he had 20, about the size of this class. Choose one of you to live, and the rest of you are gone. Okay, so how does that affect someone? Especially someone pretty young. 19, 20 years old. He goes on and talks about the scouring of the Shire. And he says, some people say that the scouring of the Shire reflects the time of England at the end of the Second World War. Peter Jackson doesn't even include the scouring of the Shire in Return of the King. He doesn't think it's important. Tolkien says it's so important, it was foreseen at the beginning of the novel. He already knew when he began writing it what was going to happen at the end. Right? Probably because of his understanding of history, right? And how history works. And he says, in fact, that it does have some basis in his own personal experience. "The country in which I lived in childhood was being shabbily destroyed before I was 10, in days when motor cars were rare objects and men were still building suburban railways." Tolkien did not like automobiles. He didn't like trains. He didn't like modernity. He was born about 800 years too late. He would have been much, much better, actually, probably more like 1,000 years too late. He would have been much, much better off if he'd been born around the year 800 and become a monk. That's where he could just write, compose poems and such. Right? So why does he include all that? He's attempting to guide our reading. He wants us to maybe not pay attention to what some critics have said, okay, about The Lord of the Rings, and to read it for ourselves. He tells us, why did he write The Lord of the Rings? Because he wanted to write, how did he put it? He wanted to write, I didn't read this part. The prime motive was the desire of a tale teller to try his hand at a really long story. Did he succeed? Yeah, it's a really long story. That would hold the attention of readers. It obviously has, because people are still buying this thing 70 years after it was published, almost 70 years. It's the second best-selling series after Harry Potter, right? In history. Would hold the attention of readers, amuse them, delight them, and at times maybe excite them or deeply move them. He says, that was my goal. He had as a guide only the kind of stuff he liked. Sir Gawain and the Grey Knight, Beowulf, Old Norse sagas, other Germanic literature. Kind of mixes it all up in that cauldron story that he talks about. Out comes this. Okay? So, start with a long-expected party. If you're familiar with The Hobbit, what does The Hobbit begin with? An unexpected party. Okay. When a bunch of dwarves show up on Bilbo's doorstep. So this is a long expected party. We know, if we read the prologue and such, we know how Bilbo came into possession of the ring. We know a little bit about the history of the ring. Okay. And this chapter is kind of designed to tell us how Frodo comes to live with Bilbo, what their relationship is, all that kind of stuff, and about the party itself. Okay? Why does Bilbo throw the party? Celebrate his birthday. Why else? Celebrate Frodo's coming of age. Louder? His parting. Okay? Hobbits do what on their birthdays? They give gifts, okay? So he invites 144 people so that he has to give away 144 gifts. All that is designed to do what? It's to make it easier to give away one thing. The ring. As he's distributing, it's designed to make it easier for him to release the ring. But notice, when he gets back to number four bag in, and Gandalf is there, he doesn't give away the ring. He puts the ring in an envelope, he seals the envelope, he goes to put it on the mantle, and he sticks it in his pocket instead. Gandalf is there, and they start to talk. Does Gandalf ever tell Bilbo, you must give up the ring? Does he ever try to take it from him?
No.
Okay. All he does is encourage him about the decision he's already previously made. And even Bilbo gives a description of himself that kind of, you know, if Gandalf had Spock's ears, his ears would perk up a little bit. I am old, Gandalf. I don't look it. This is page 32. But I'm beginning to feel it in my heart of hearts. He says, I feel like butter that's been scraped over too much bread. Okay? What does he mean? Have you stayed awake for 36 hours before? Or 48 hours? You pretty much feel like a zombie after 28 hours awake. Bilbo is saying, I need a rest. But he can't get the rest while he has the ring. Or, to put it another way, while the ring has him. But he doesn't understand that. So, they continue talking. And he gets a little upset at Gandalf. And he calls the ring his precious. And then it's Gandalf's turn to get upset. Okay? He comes out, Bilbo comes out and says, if you want the ring, why don't you say so? Then Gandalf gets really upset and says, if you want to see Gandalf the Grey uncloaked, go ahead, just keep going. What does that mean, uncloaked? Yeah, if you want me to reveal my power to you, little puny hobbit, short midget-like person, go right ahead and do that. Okay? We do see Gandalf uncloaked at a couple of points. We're going to see him uncloaked, so to speak, at Casa Doom. We're going to see him uncloaked partially at the Forge of Bruinen. We're going to see him really uncloaked. Later on, okay? So, Bilbo leaves the ring in the envelope on the mantle and leaves. Frodo shows up, tells Gandalf he would have loved to have gone off with him, etc. But Gandalf tells Bilbo, Bilbo tells Gandalf, Frodo is still too in love with the Shire, with the hills and the fields and the streams. Okay? So we get to Shadow of the Past. There are two crucial chapters in this particular volume. The Shadow of the Past. Okay, and the Council of Elrond. The Shadow of the Past is the second chapter of Book 1. Council of Elrond is the second chapter of Book 2. There are actually six books in The Lord of the Rings. Books 1 and 2 make Volume 1, The Fellowship of the Ring. Books 3 and 4 make Volume 2, The Two Towers. And Books 5 and 6 make Volume 3, The Return of the King. Okay? So you've got The Shadow of the Past and The Council of Elrond. The purpose of both of these chapters is exposition. We're given background information that we need in order to understand what is happening, in order to follow along. Okay? In the film, or films, a lot of this exposition from The Shadow of the Past is given by Cate Blanchett at the beginning of the film. It's kind of done in flashback form. Okay? Cate Blanchett, Galadriel's character. So we get The Shadow of the Past. Gandalf goes away at the end of the previous chapter, and then he stays away for a long time. He comes back, and he leaves again. Okay? Frodo is 33 in the first chapter. Okay? How old is he when he leaves with the ring?
50.
He's the same age Bilbo is when Bilbo went off on his adventure with the dwarves. So 17 years go by. Now, when Bilbo leaves, Gandalf already has expressed some of his concern about the ring. He says, it is, after all, a magical ring. Be careful. Okay? He tells Frodo, be careful. Don't use it unless you have to. And then he kind of pops in and out every now and then for about 17 years. Okay? So he comes back. When he comes back, strange rumors had been coming into the Shire. Talk about the elves moving west and other things. Talk about the Dark Tower being rebuilt. Okay. And we see Sam holding forth at the Green Dragon. Notice in the first chapter, it's Sam's father, the Gaffer, holding forth at, not the Green Dragon, it's the other one. Can't remember the name of the other pub. And Sam is talking, and he's talking with Ted Sandyman and others. Ted Sandyman is the son of the previous miller. And just as his father, the Gaffer, did not get along with the miller, Sam doesn't get along with his son either. Okay? So they're talking about Frodo and such. Sam says Frodo's a good guy and all this. The Ivy Bush, thank you. Okay, page 46. Gandalf was returned, and he and Frodo start to talk about the ring. And then Gandalf's kind of like, we should probably stop talking about this, because it's getting late, it's dark, and we'll talk in the morning. Next morning, they're having a pipe together, and Frodo says, last night you began to tell me strange things about my ring, Gandalf, and then you stopped because you said that such matters were best left until daylight. Why? In what way is the ring dangerous? In many ways, it is far more powerful than I ever dared to think at first. Notice what he says. So powerful that in the end, it would utterly overcome anyone of mortal race who possessed it. It would possess him. Okay, now what has Tolkien just told us through Gandalf about the ring and anybody who tries to possess the ring? They'll fail. It will possess them. Anyone of mortal race will be overcome by the ring. Okay? Got to get that clear. He says that from the outset. Is Frodo immortal?
No.
No. Okay? So what's going to happen? He'll be possessed. He'll be controlled by the ring if he tries to control the ring or own the ring for too long. Okay? So then Gandalf goes into the history of ring making. It says, next page, immortal Frodo, who keeps one of the great rings, does not die. Okay. But he does not grow or obtain more life. He merely continues until at last every minute is a weariness. Notice the kind of immortality one of the great rings will confer. We kind of like to think immortality, oh man, that would be wonderful. You just keep going on, and life gets more and more wonderful. No, it doesn't. According to this, it's like staying awake for 30 hours, and then 40 hours, and 48 hours, and then 60 hours, and then 72 hours, and 120 hours, and never going to sleep. You just get weary. You just get tired. And if he often uses the ring to make himself invisible, he fades. He becomes, in the end, invisible permanently. And walks in the twilight under the eye of the dark power that rules the rings. Yes, sooner or later. Later, if he is strong or well-meaning to begin with. But neither strength nor good purpose will last. Sooner or later, the dark power will devour him. Okay? How long did Gollum have the ring? Hundreds of years. Gollum's about 600 years old when we meet him. Here. Okay? Gollum should not be 600 years old. Gollum probably shouldn't live to be 100. Most hobbits don't live to be 100. That's why it's kind of interesting that Bilbo is 111 and he looks well preserved. Okay?
What was Gollum?
Well, Gandalf's going to tell us he's an ancestor, so to speak, of hobbits, or he's related to hobbits. Frodo's not going to like that idea very much. Okay, so Frodo says, how long have you known this? And how much did Bilbo know? Gandalf takes the questions in reverse order. Bilbo didn't know any more than he told you. In other words, Bilbo didn't know anything that I'm telling you now. Okay? So Frodo then asks again, how long have you known all this? Gandalf, known? I've known much that only the wise know, Frodo. Now that's kind of a Gandalf put down to Frodo. He takes Frodo's question to be saying, how long have you known everything that you know? How old is Gandalf? He's older than Gollum. Not thousands, but he's a little over 1,000. Okay, here's another question. What is Gandalf?
Wizard.
Okay, he's a wizard. What's a wizard? Are you sure about that?
No, he's not an elf. He's not an immortal. It doesn't really tell you.
He's not an elf. He's not an immortal. He can be killed. Okay. Bridge of Casa Doom. To answer that question, you've got to read the Silmarillion. Or you can read the appendices in the back of the book, where Tolkien does give us a little bit more information. Gandalf goes by a variety of names. He's got various aliases, let's say, you know, depending on what part of the world he's in. So the elves call him Mithrandir. Okay? think the people of Gondor call him the Grey Pilgrim. Hobbits call him just Gandalf. In the West, he says, of my youth, he was called Olorin. Okay? And by the West of my youth, he's talking about in the time in the Second Age when the world was shaped differently than it is currently in Middle-earth. Okay? Gandalf went by this name. But even then, that doesn't answer what is Gandalf. Gandalf is what's called a Maia. Okay? In Tolkien's cosmology, you have, I'm going to get way behind you. You have Eru, Ilúvatar. You can just call him God. Okay? Beneath Eru, Ilúvatar, okay, he is uncreated. He is like the Christian God. Okay? Beneath Eru, Ilúvatar, you have the Ainur. Ainur are essentially angelic beings that Ilúvatar creates. He sings them into being. Okay? The Ainur are made up of, once they enter Middle Earth, okay, they're called either the Valar or the Maiar. Okay? When they're out there in Ilúvatar land, outside Arda, the world that is created, they're just called Ainur, right? And the Ainur are named, okay? The highest, the greatest of the Ainur is named Melkor. And what essentially happens in the Silmarillion is Ilúvatar creates the Ainur, and you have Melkor, and you have the one who's kind of his brother, Manwë. These are the two most powerful. Okay. And Ilúvatar says, sing. And so the Ainur start to sing. Okay. This happens three times. And as the Ainur sing, Melkor kind of takes his fingers to his chalkboard. Goes. He introduces discord into the harmony that the Ainur are singing. And Ilúvatar says, okay, stop. Okay, we're going to try that again. Ready? One, two. And he conducts, and the Ainur start to sing again. And again, Melkor introduces more discord. This time, Ainur, the first time he raised his left hand, kind of mean stop. This time he raises his right hand, stop. Kind of gives Melkor the evil eye. He says, all right, third time, they sing, the music's beautiful. Melkor introduces horrible, horrible discord. This time, Ainur stands. Ilúvatar stands. He goes, okay, let me just show you what you've done. Unbeknownst to you, you were creating just now. You created the world and everything in it. Okay? Let me show you what you've done. And he kind of puts on the screen what they've sung. And he says, Melkor, every time you brought in discord, what happens? In Arda, the world that's created, doesn't just mean Earth. It means the physical universe, per se. He says, here's where you've introduced evil. So for the first time, we see this evil introduced. And then we get the second theme, the second time they sing. Okay, and we see good coming out of the evil. Because Ilúvatar is the one in control. And then we see more evil creep in. He cuts them off. They sing again. And he says, okay, now let me show you what you've done. Right? And that's the history of the world. With this big exception. What humans do is not part of what is sung. Elves' lives. Dwarves' lives. Yep. They're bound by what was sung. Humans are not. Okay? So, after all this happens, Eru then says, let it be. That is, the music you sung, let it be. That is, make it real. And the universe comes into being. And in that universe is Arda, a planet that we would call Earth. Okay? Melkor gets the grand idea of saying, I'm going to go down here because he's seen the vision. And he's going to go down here and he's going to screw it up. Why? Because this is the only way he can get back at a real Uvatar. It's like somebody trying to get back at a bully. You get back at the bully by beating up the bully. Well, now if the bully is a whole lot bigger than you, what do? You go kick his cat. Or, shoot his dog or something. So, I'm going to go pick on his playthings. Elves, humans, dwarves, etc. Okay? So Melkor comes down here. He gets a new name. Morgoth. Right. When the Ainur leave the presence of Iluvatar and come into the world, that's when they get one of these two classifications, either the Valar or the Maiar. The Valar are the highest ranking of them. There's like a total of 12, I think. Right. The Maiar are next to level. So, think Christian cosmology. You have at the top of the ranking of angels, the cherubim and seraphim. Okay? They're the highest ranking angels. Okay? Beneath those you have archangels, thrones, principalities, powers, dominions, rulers, blah, 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 blah. All the way down to your everyday, ordinary, garden variety angels. Angel just means messenger. That's all it is. They're, heavenly postmen, as it were, okay? Delivering the news. So, the Maiar are not this level. They're somewhere in here. Gandalf's one of these. Yeah, Gandalf's a supernatural being. So is Saruman. So is Radagast the Brown, who likes to drive a sledge driven by, massive bunnies and smoke his weed. So is Sauron. Sauron is a Maiar. The Balrogs are all Maiar. Okay, so when Gandalf says at the Bridge of Concept Doom, the Balrog, what he means is, damn, an equal. If it were just a troll, be no problem. But Balrogs have powers like Gandalf has powers. Okay? So that's kind of that, all that kind of background. So, how long have you known all this? Gandalf's kind of going, who do you think you are? What do you mean, how long? I've known all this since way long time ago. Okay? So, when did I first begin to guess? Oh, let's see. It's the year the White Council drove the Dark Power from Mirkwood. Let's see, when was that? Oh, yeah, right after Bilbo found the ring. Bilbo's little story to me of how he came by the ring, sounded fishy. Didn't quite believe him. Okay? So they keep talking. Gandalf mentions Saruman the White. Frodo asks, who is he? Gandalf says, he's the leader of my order, blah, 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 blah. He's very wise. He's very powerful. His knowledge is very deep. But his pride has grown with his knowledge. A little bit of foreshadowing. Okay? So Gandalf goes on to explain about Sauron in the ring. And he says, Sauron would like to have slaves, and he'd like to get revenge. Frodo, why? Why should we be enslaved? Why should he want such slaves? And Gandalf says, he doesn't need you. He has many other more useful servants, but he won't forget you again. There is such a thing as malice and revenge. In other words, just sheer rotten evilness. Okay? Revenge. Revenge for what? I don't understand. Frodo's saying. Again, it's like, Frodo, you ought to start to understand. It has everything to do with it. He says, give me the ring for a moment. Notice he doesn't say, give me the ring. Why not? Because that could be a command. Give me the ring for a moment implies a temporal quality. Exactly. I'm just going to look at it. It doesn't mean give me the ring for good. Okay? So, Gandalf holds it up, says, no writing. Nope, no writing. And he throws it in Frodo's little fire. And Frodo has a little hissy fit. He has to wait. Ring gets all nice, hot, and glowing. Gandalf reaches in with tongs, pulls it out. And it says, here, Frodo. Okay, it's been in the fire. He pulls it out, holding it with the tongs. How long is he holding it before he drops it in Frodo's hand? Seconds. What should Frodo do? Hell no. It's going to be hot. Okay? But he doesn't. He catches it. Why? Because Frodo's little fire isn't nearly hot enough to heat this thing up. It's just hot enough to bring out the writing. Frodo, I can't read the fiery letters. No, said Gandalf, but I can. So can I, if I find the passage. Ashnaz Durbatulik, Ashnaz Gimbatul, Ashnaz Thrakatulik, Agburzim Ishikrimbatul. Okay? One ring to rule them all, one ring to find them, one ring to bring them all, and in the darkness bind them. And he says, Frodo, that's only two lines of a long, much longer verse, long known in elven lore. But it's what two lines? It's the last two lines, and it's the most important two lines. Frodo, you got the one ring, the master ring, the ring that governs, controls, binds all the other rings. How on earth did it come to me? Frodo asks. Gandalf, long story. He says, last night I told you of Sauron the Great, the Dark Lord. Rumors you've heard, they're true. What does he mean, the rumors? Stories about the elves leaving, stories about the Dark Tower being rebuilt. What are the stories of the Dark Tower to the hobbits? What kind of stories are they? Fairy tales. Fairy tales aren't real. They're not real. This one is. Okay. So think of a fairy tale you're familiar with and suddenly have it be real. I mean, Hansel and Gretel. Okay, maybe the little old witch wasn't a little old witch. Maybe her name was Jeffrey Dahmer and he lived in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. And he ate 11 people. Okay, that's one way to look at it. Okay. Jack and the Beanstalk. That would be kind of mind-blowing, right? You find a bean, you throw it in the ground, and it grows up as high, and you climb, and you reach a land of giants. Huh. So he says, he has indeed arisen again, left his hold in Mirkwood, returned to his ancient fastness. That name even you hobbits have heard of. I love this phrase. Like a shadow on the borders of old stories. Okay, first, it's like a shadow. Describe a shadow. Dark. What else? No, it's not refracted. It's a lack of light.
It's, going off of that, it's kind of there, but not there.
Okay. It's insubstantial, right? You can't touch a shadow. Okay. It's real, but it's not real. So it's like a shadow on the old borders. What are the borders of something? The edges, the outer edges, okay? Old maps, maps drawn in the 1300s, 1400s and such, would have the known world, and then they'd have beyond the known world, terra incognita, unknown land. That's the borders, okay? So, like a shadow on the borders of old borders. Old stories like fairy tales. Stories that people don't believe. Okay? So what's he saying? Real hard to believe stuff. Always after a defeat and a respite, the shadow takes another shape and grows again. In other words, always after evil is defeated, there's a respite, and then it takes a new shape and grows again. Just look at, you know, real world history. Let's talk about applicability for a moment. Prior to 2000, what was the other, let's say, the 20th century, what was the main great evil? Okay.
Germany.
Well, no, let's leave Germany out for a moment, because Germany was short. Hitler came to power in 33, he lost power in 45. Communism. Okay? Communism. If you're talking about from the Western point of view, okay, how long did it last? Well, in Russia, roughly 1917 to 1989, it's a pretty good run. 72 years. Okay? The shadow takes another shape and grows again. 1989, the Soviet Union falls. Communism isn't dead. Just go ask Kim Jong Crazy over in North Korea, okay? Or Fidel down in Cuba. Always after a defeat and a respite, the shadow takes another shape and grows again. What's the quote-unquote great evil of our time? It's not communism. Well, take that back. It's not communism. Russia, however, I would say, you better keep a pretty close eye on. Just yesterday, another one of Putin's quote-unquote former enemies, a journalist who had left Russia, set up shop in Ukraine, was found dead in his apartment from an apparent suicide. This is like the 12th one in the last 4 or 5 years. All these people that Putin doesn't get along with, surprisingly, they keep killing themselves.
Yes. Wasn't the leader of the KGB?
He wasn't the leader. He was in the KGB. Yeah.
Well, he was a pretty high up.
Like, yeah, he was pretty. He was pretty high up.
I mean, that would be like us taking like someone that's very good at killing people and putting them in like a presidential position.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm sure he has.
Well, I mean, George H.W. Bush was head of CIA in 1970. He was elected president. We could debate whether or not Putin was actually elected president. Russian elections are not known for their democracy, let's say. Okay? So what is our evil? Terrorism? Notice, does it have a single name? Not anymore. It's transnational. It's, you know, international conglomerate, so to speak. Okay? But the shadow takes another shape. So what's the shadow? It's not communism. It's not fascism. It's not an ism per se. It's kind of evil personified, if you want. Okay? I'm starting to think of anything. It's iconoclasm. Iconoclasm means to destroy icons. Icons, in a religious sense, are like paintings. Paintings of Christ, paintings of Mary, paintings of the saints and such. But what's meant by that? They're images. Okay? So what are they really images of?
Ideas.
People. Okay. And within the Christian tradition, people are images of God. Because man is made in the image and likeness of God. So iconoclasm is ultimately this idea of destroying God. Well, what did the Taliban do with those great Buddhist sculptures in Afghanistan? 2,000-year-old sculptures, 90 feet tall. They were like UNESCO World Heritage things. Boom, they blew them up. What did ISIS do when it overran much of Syria? It started going to places that, again, were UNESCO World Heritage sites and blowing them up, okay? Or places in Iraq. I mean, there's a town in Iraq. It had what was called the Tomb of Jonah. Of Jonah and the whale Jonah. Jonah, the Old Testament book Jonah. Okay? And they blew it up. This thing was over 2,000 years old. They blew it up. Why? It's not in the Quran. Or at least it's not in their reading of the Quran. So, the shadow takes another shape and grows again. Look at Frodo's reply. I wish it need not have happened in my time. Now, what kind of reply is that?
Why me? Your head in the sand.
Exactly. I want to be an ostrich and stick my head in. Yeah. Why me? Do you think that when George Bush was reading My Pet Goat to a group of kindergarten students on September 11th, 2001, and Andy Card, his chief of staff, comes up and goes, Mr. President, we're under attack. Do you think he just went, yes, now I can invade Iraq? Which is what some people want you to believe? I imagine he... Why didn't this happen 9 months ago? Under Clinton's watch. Why couldn't this happen under Clinton's watch? Let Clinton have to. Okay. He never publicly said, why me? But he did say something very close to what Gandalf says next. So do I. And so do all who live to see such times. I mean, think about Frodo's statement, and you can apply it not just to the shadow of rises again. Think about the divisions, let's say, within the United States. And I've got in-laws who were first responders, a brother-in-law who was a cop for 27 years, a brother who was a 911 dispatcher for 26 years. You know, they're the real first responders because they have to deal with the calls that come in, okay? You think, you know, when they hear about, you know, cops being shot, ambushed, that they think, I wish this didn't happen in my time. You betcha. And then you get the bigger stuff, 9/11 and such. So do all who live to see such times. But that is not for them to decide. What does he mean, that is not for them to decide?
It's out of their control.
It's out of their control. Put it in modern, everyday language. So, too bad. Suck it up. That's what Gandalf's saying. Okay?
Is that what, I mean, just not to, just reminisce of the weird we're talking about, as well, like the whole idea of weird.
Yeah, kind of. Kind of. So what does he say? All we have to decide is what to do with the time that is given us. That's what Bush essentially said in that speech to Congress in 2001. We've been attacked. We have to decide what to do. Okay? And already, Frodo, our time is beginning to look black. He's not saying black is inherently evil or bad. He's using it as a description for, like, the falling of nighttime. What happens when nighttime comes?
You can't see.
You can't see. Okay? He's saying our time, you know, the sun is setting. We don't have much time left. The enemy is fast becoming very strong. His plans are far from ripe, but they are ripening. We shall be hard put to it. We should be very hard put to it, even if it were not for this dreadful chance. What's the dreadful chance?
The ring is in their possession.
Exactly. We have the ring, Sauron doesn't. He lacks the one ring. So he goes on and talks about what happened to the three. Three elven rings, okay? He says those are hid from him. The seven, the dwarf kings, possessed. Three of those, Sauron has. The others, the dragons have consumed. Nine he gave to mortal men. He's got all those. So there's just the one that's now missing. All the others have been accounted for. Right? So, he says, the nine he's gathered to himself. He has the nine riders. The seven also, or they're destroyed. The three are hidden. So he only needs the one. If he has the one, then he can command all the rings that survive. He already commands the nine that the men have. What it means, he can command the three that the elves have. Okay? And here's the chance, Frodo. He thought the one had perished. But now he knows it hasn't perished. Frodo, why wasn't it destroyed? How did the enemy ever come to lose it if he was so strong and it was so precious? Gandalf, it was taken from him. When? In a battle, Isildur cuts the ring from Sauron's hand. Cuts his finger off. Okay? Isildur claims the ring. The ring betrays him. He's shot. The ring falls into the river Anduin. And then Gandalf gives us this story about Diagol and Sméagol. Right? And what do we discover? Long time ago, it's this one guy's birthday, and he wants a present from his cousin, and his cousin doesn't give it to him, so he kills him. And he takes the nice golden sparkly thing from him. Okay? Gollum, Frodo cries, page 54. You mean Gollum? That Bilbo met? How loathsome. I think it's a sad story. And it might have happened to others, even to some hobbits that I know. In other words, get off your high horse there, little boy. Quit thinking that this can't happen to you. I can't believe Gollum was connected with hobbits, however distantly. Why? Why can't Frodo accept that Gollum was a hobbit? Okay, it would mean they have something in common. What else would it mean?
He doesn't want to believe that he can become Gollum himself.
Bingo. What does everybody say about him? Oh, he was crazy. He was crazy. That's what it was. He was insane. What if he wasn't?
He was just smart.
He was
smart.
Very
smart.
He's
very
smart.
You can be intelligent and still use your intelligence for evil purposes.
Yeah. Okay. He is a rhetorical master. He moved people with his words. That's why it's always dangerous whenever you have a politician who's really smooth in speech. Okay? You gotta put on that extra tinfoil hat and go, no, I'm not listening. Okay? Because he could move people just with the power of his words. Why else? Because if that could happen to Gollum, it could happen to me. Right? What an abominable notion. Gandalf, it's true all the same. In other words, it doesn't matter what you think of it, Frodo. Just because you're repelled by it or repulsed by it doesn't change the reality. Just because you might not like something doesn't mean it's not true. So they keep talking. And Gandalf says, you know, and this is probably the most interesting thing in the entire history of the ring. How Bilbo, who gets knocked on the head while being carried on the back of one of the dwarves in the tunnels of the Misty Mountains, okay, falls on the ground, is unconscious for a while, wakes up, is moving around like this, his hand comes upon a ring, and he just picks it up and sticks it in his pocket. What? Just in time to meet Bilbo? Wouldn't an orc have suited it better, Frodo says. Gandalf, it's not a laughing matter. Not for you. It was the strangest event in the whole history of the ring. He says there was more than one power at work, Frodo. The ring was trying to get back to its master. What does that mean about the ring?
It has will.
Why? Because Sauron poured most of his power into the creation of this ring. See, the ring, and I'm going to probably step on some toes here, intentionally. The ring is not like an AK-47. Okay? The ring is inherently evil. An AK-47 is not inherently evil. Can it be used for evil purposes? You're damn right. Okay? Can the ring be good used for good purposes? Zilch. Never. Okay? It is evil. Period. Okay? So, they keep talking. And Gandalf says, as I said, the ring was trying to get back to its master. It slipped from Isildur's hand. Okay? It revealed itself. Diagol found it. Gollum stole it. Gollum kept it. And then it slipped from Gollum's hand, just in time to be found by Bilbo of the Shire. But then he goes on and says, but behind that, page 56, there was something else at work. beyond any design of the ringmaker. So we're being told the ring was working, the ring maker was working or intending, but behind both of those, there is another power at work. What's the other power? Is it Gandalf? Is it Saruman? I think it's a Rivoluvatar. This is the Boethian element. That no matter what happens, God is still in control. Right? Tolkien said in one of his letters about the Lord of the Rings. He says, the Lord of the Rings is fundamentally, what does that mean? In its foundation. Right? The Lord of the Rings is fundamentally a religious and philosophical work. More so in the revising than in the creation. That is, more so as he revised. That is, as he revised, his religious kind of ideology couldn't help but creep in. Okay? He's Catholic. Catholics acknowledge the what's called the providence of God. No matter what happens, God is always in control. He allows everything that happens. Why? So that we can understand it down here? Nope, not at all. Okay? So, I can put it no plainer than by saying that Bilbo was meant to find the ring and not by its maker, in which case you also were meant to have it. Okay? If you're going to say somebody was meant to have something, then there has to be somebody meaning them to have it. So there has to be a meanor back here. Okay? Frodo, that's not comforting. What do you mean that should be comforting? That I was meant to have the ring. Okay, who is Sauron? Put Sauron in our kind of real world terms. He's not Hitler or Stalin or anybody like that. Satan. Yeah, so I'm supposed to confront Satan on my own. That's not comforting. Okay. He says, how much of this do you really know, or are you still guessing? Gandalf looks at Frodo and his eyes glinted. His eyes glinted? That means, ooh, careful there, Junior. Don't push. Right? Gandalf says, the writing on your ring proves what I'm saying. Well, when did you discover that? When you read the writing on the ring, dummy. Right? So Gandalf says, I've seen Gollum. I've talked to him. Okay? And what else does he reveal? Where has Gollum been?
Mordor.
After Bilbo took the ring, Gollum eventually had the courage to come out from his hidey hole. He makes his way down to Mordor, where he has a little chat with Sauron. And Sauron learns two names. Shire and Baggins. Okay? At least he doesn't know number four, Bagshot Row, Hobbiton, the Shire, west of Middle-earth. You know. Okay? So, Gandalf says he may even be seeking the Shire now, if he's not already found out where it lies. Frodo, this is terrible. Far worse than the worst that I imagined from your hints and warnings, page 59. O Gandalf, best of friends, what am I to do? For now, I am really afraid. What am I to do? Okay, notice, I am really afraid. He probably needs to go change his underwear. He's that afraid. Okay? What a pity Bilbo did not stab that vile creature when he had a chance. What does he mean that it was a pity that Bilbo didn't kill Gollum when he had a chance? Yeah, Gollum wouldn't have told Sauron, and I, Frodo, would be still fat, dumb, and happy in my little hobbit hole. Okay? But Gandalf hears that and says, pity? Okay? It was pity that stayed his hand. Pity and mercy not to strike without need. And he has been well rewarded, Frodo. Be sure that he took so little hurt from the evil and escaped in the end because he began his ownership of the ring so. With pity. What does Frodo mean? What a pity that Bilbo did not stab him. What a shame that Bilbo didn't off him when he could. And if you're familiar with The Hobbit, Bilbo could have killed Gollum. But rather than killing him, he jumps over him to get beyond him. He's wearing the ring, so he's invisible, so he's not seen. Okay? Bilbo, I'm sorry, Frodo, I'm sorry, but I am frightened, and I do not feel any pity for Gollum. Notice what is motivating his speech. Fear. I'm frightened, and I don't feel any pity for Gollum. You have not seen him. What's Gandalf mean? You see him, and you will pity him. No, and I don't want to. Why doesn't he want to see him? Because he doesn't want to pity him. It's a lot easier to feel fear and hatred of somebody, right? Than it is to have to go up to them and shake hands with them. There's an old Phil Collins song. I can't remember the title, but it's about walking down a street and seeing a homeless person and crossing on the other side of the road. Okay. Why? To pretend like it's not an issue. To pretend like the person isn't there. Because that homeless person does what? Maybe to your nice little wonderful view of reality. Blows it up. No, and I don't want to. I can't understand you. Do you mean to say that you and the elves have let him live on after all those horrible deeds? Now, at any rate, he is as bad as an orc and just an enemy. He deserves death. Boy, can Frodo pack an awful lot into a little outburst. So, what does he mean that, do you mean to say that you and the elves have let him live? What did Gandalf say about the elves and Gollum? He captured Gollum and, the elves are kind of holding Gollum prisoner. Nicely, they're treating him well, okay? So, you have let him live on after all those horrible deeds. What horrible deeds particularly? Okay, he killed his friend. Pretty bad. What are the other ones?
That's bad.
Snitching.
Well, yeah, he used the ring to steal from people. Okay, so, petty theft, let's say. What else? He killed goblins. Most people would say, okay, that kind of balances out the murder of Diagol, maybe. Yeah. What else?
Kept the ring for himself.
Yeah, but he's under the power of the ring. You can't really blame him for that.
Okay. Sought out Sauron.
And gave up Bilbo. Okay. Those are the horrible deeds that Frodo's thinking of. Now, at any rate, he is as bad as an orc and just an enemy. What does that word just mean? Exactly. Only. He's nothing else but an enemy. What do to enemies? Boom. You kill them. You don't negotiate with enemies. Enemies you kill. That's how you win. Period. Okay? Deserves it? Because Frodo says he deserves death. What has Frodo just made himself? God. It's a little higher than I was thinking, but okay. Judge, prosecutor, and jury.
Without even knowing, personally.
Right? He deserves death. Deserves it? I dare say he does. That's Gandalf saying, yeah, you're right, Frodo. He probably does deserve to die. Many that live deserve death. And some that die deserve life. Wait a second. Many that live deserve death. Okay, we can understand that part. Some that die deserve life. Wait. It's not supposed to work that way. People that die are supposed to be the people who are supposed to die. Yeah, tell that to a 3-year-old who gets brain cancer. No, not supposed to die. Not supposed to happen that way. Just, in last week's earthquake in Italy, They discovered 15 hours after the earthquake, a four-year-old, I think it was a four-year-old, maybe it was a two-year-old, in the arms of a nine-year-old. Two-year-old sister, nine-year-old sister. The nine-year-old died, but she died protecting her two-year-old sister. Protecting her from the falling rubble. Some that die deserve life. Can you give it to them? What's the problem with people that are dead? They stay dead. Okay? We're going to hear that in Harry Potter. We're going to hear somebody say, Diggory, back from the dead. And Dumbledore's going to say, no, there is no spell that can raise the dead. Huh. Can you give it to them? What kind of question is that? It's a rhetorical question. There's not a yes or no answer. There's no answer to it. Okay? Then do not be too eager to deal out death in judgment. What is Gandalf saying? Don't assume you know all. What does Frodo say? He deserves death. Why? He is only an enemy. Why? He's as bad as orcs. Okay. Orcs are like the ring. They are inherently evil. There's nothing good about them. Okay. Not in this book, at least. Okay. Orcs, their origins, they were originally elves that Melkor / Morgoth twisted and then bred. And he kept twisting and breeding and twisting and breeding and twisting and breeding until they were completely un-elves. Right? So now they're thoroughly evil. There's nothing redeeming about an orc. If there were orcs in our real world, there would probably be hunting parties for them. And I mean parties. Let's go get drunk and let's go hunt us some orcs, you know. Arm up, boys. That kind of thing. Okay? But that's not what Gandalf's talking about. Yeah, I dare say he does deserve death. Many that live deserve death, and some that die deserve life. Notice, he doesn't say many that die deserve life. Some. What's he suggesting? Sometimes people are killed wrongly. Problem with the killing them is you can't bring them back. Then do not be too eager to deal out death and judgment, for even the very wise cannot see all ends. What does he mean by ends? Outcomes? Conclusions? What else does he mean? Because there's another meaning to that. Like a phrase, such and such is the means to an end. The end here is not this. It's purpose or intention. Even the very wise cannot see all purposes, all intentions. I have not much hope that Gollum can be cured before he dies, but there is a chance of it. Now, that, I think, is entirely Tolkien's religious thought coming through. Because what's he talking about? Gollum, I mean, one of you asked me at the beginning of class, why did I think, you know, what was left out of the end of the seventh Harry Potter film? The offer of redemption to Lord Voldemort. That's exactly what Gandalf is talking about here. He says, I have not much hope that Gollum, what? Can be cured before he dies. Okay, so if you need a cure, then what's wrong with you? You're sick. If you're sick, is it necessarily your fault? If you are an alcoholic, a literal alcoholic. Is it your fault that you're an alcoholic? No, it is not. That is your genes speaking. So what does that mean if you're an alcoholic? If this is whiskey, you better stay away from it. It's your fault if you drink. Okay? If you're not an alcoholic and you drink, is it bad? No. Why? Because you don't have the genes that make you not be able to handle liquor. Okay? So, I have not much hope that Gollum can be cured before he dies, but there is a chance of it. Why does he care whether or not Gollum is cured? Just kill the little dirty, rotten SOB and be done with it, right? A lot better than sending them off to jail and having the, you know, taxpayers and the people having to pay their room and board for 60 years. Yeah, Tolkien is talking about capital punishment, and he is talking about the possible, quote-unquote, salvation of those deemed worthy of capital punishment. Okay, let's bring it back to the real world. What's he talking about? I don't mean who 1954 is Tolkien talking about. I mean who today, or maybe let's say in the last 10 years, would qualify for what he's talking about. Can you think of a name? Can you think of a baddie, a real bad guy? Right. Do you remember what happened in the United States when Obama announced that Osama had bin Laden had been killed? There were parties. There were parades. Okay. Now, if you take Gandalf's words, what does that say about parties and parades? For anybody. I have not much hope that he can be cured before he dies. Not much hope is more than no hope, right? Okay? And he is bound up with the fate of the ring. Notice, Gandalf gives a reason why he wants Gollum to find his cure. He is bound up with the fate of the ring. My heart tells me he has some part to play yet for good or ill before the end. And when that comes, the pity of Bilbo may rule the fate of many, yours not least. And what Peter Jackson does with Gollum at the end, he ought to be killed for. He ought to be shot, drawn and quartered, beheaded, burned at the stake, ashes scattered. Okay? Let me just get clear what I think about Peter Jackson and the end of the series. He doesn't understand what Tolkien is doing in The Lord of the Rings. How does Peter Jackson read The Lord of the Rings? What does The Lord of the Rings become? Okay, other than a film. What kind of film? Sci-fi, action. You guys aren't old enough. None of you probably ever played this. I didn't play it because I was that nerdy or geeky of a kid. But there's a game really popular in the 80s and 90s. Dungeons and Dragons. This is, in Peter Jackson's mind, Dungeons and Dragons. This is nothing but sword and sorcery. The sword and sorcery are incidental to Tolkien's story. Okay? There's something much, much deeper going on. Just like in the Harry Potter novels, the so-called magic that brought the right-wing wacko Christians out of the woodwork, and just to lay cards on the table, I am a right-wing wacko Christian, okay? Started a church in town. I'm far more right-wing than most politicians are. Not Republican, however, more conservative, libertarian, etc. But they're complete idiots because they don't know how to read books before they want to burn them. Okay? The magic of the Harry Potter stories is not in the magic of the Harry Potter stories. It's in the values and virtues that are expressed in the Harry Potter stories. Nowhere in the Harry Potter stories do you have someone say, serve Satan, become a witch, sacrifice a baby, you know, kill chickens. Yeah, chickens are killed, okay? But there's none of that. Instead, what do you have? Love your neighbor, okay? Be loyal. Be good. Defend the defenseless. Protect the weak. These are all good things, most people would say. I know some people would quibble with them and say, no, get go for what you want out of life, screw everybody else, get the most. He who dies with the most toys wins. Okay? So, Frodo listens to all this. He says, it's almost like what he hears from Gandalf is, wah, 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 wah. He's not listening. All the same, even if Bilbo could not kill Gollum, I wish he had not kept the ring. I wish he had never found it and that I had not got it. Why did you let me keep it? Why didn't you make me throw it away or destroy it? If I were filming it, I would have Gandalf probably go up to Frodo about that point and almost slap him upside the head and say, are you listening? Have you not heard a word? Okay. He says, your little fire barely even heats it up. You don't have a hammer big enough to put a dent on it. There aren't any dragons hot enough anymore to melt this ring. You want to destroy this ring? Frodo, there's one way. Take it to Mount Doom, throw it in the fires. Frodo, page 61. I do really wish to destroy it. Okay. Notice the agency there. That is an active tense. I do really wish to destroy it. The subject is I. Okay? And then he catches himself. Because look what he says next. Or, well, to have it destroyed. What does it mean to have it destroyed? We've gone from active voice to passive voice. I do really wish to destroy it. Or can somebody over there please destroy it for here? I'll just kind of leave it here and you take it. Why? He says, I'm not made for perilous quests. Neither was Bilbo. You know, and let's jump to the real world again. Neither were those 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22-year-old men who jumped off of amphibious, you know, ships in the English Channel as machine gun fire was raining down like hail upon them. So that some of them, before they even got to the shore, what they were running on was the backs of their dead soldier companions. The bodies were so thick in the water, men were running across the body to get to the sand. Okay? They weren't made for perilous quests. A lot of those guys were little farm boys from the Midwest and the South. They didn't grow up thinking, yay, I get a charge Normandy to free the frickin' Europeans of their own problems. Why did it come to me? Why was I chosen? There's the, why me, God? Guru, why me? Such questions cannot be answered. Next. In other words, deal with it, kid. I mean, what's Tolkien saying here? What do we hear a lot from young people? I won't say your age, even younger today, but also a lot of 20-year-old, 20 millennials, saying, why does all this stuff happen? You know, if you knew the answer to that, if you had the book, the definitive answer, you'd be a bazillionaire. Why? Because there isn't a definitive answer. The fact is, life happens. Or as a bumper sticker famously puts it, shit happens. Best thing to do is wipe it off your feet and keep on moving. Maybe it's deeper than your feet. Wipe it off your legs. Keep on, you're either two things to do. You get up and move on, or what? You lay in the shit. I don't know about you. I'd rather get up and move on. Okay? Just laying in it. Doesn't sound very attractive. Such questions cannot be answered. You may be sure that it was not for any merit that others do not possess. In other words, Frodo, it's not because of your power or wisdom, at any rate. How much wisdom has Frodo sown so far? He's like Harry Potter, a little slow on the uptake. He's a 40-watt bulb in a box of 100 watts, you know. But you have been chosen. And you must therefore use such strength and heart and wits as you have. Frodo, but I don't have any of these. Will you not take it? What is that? will you not take it? Big capital temptation. No, 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 Gandalf. You're wise. You're powerful. I don't really know what one is, but you're a Maiar. You take it. No! And Gandalf jumps away. I mean, he puts distance between himself, not in Frodo, the ring. What's happening here? This is the ring using Frodo to try to get back to Sauron. Because if Gandalf gets the ring, what's Gandalf going to do? See, the ring works according to, it's commensurate with the power of the person who owns it. So what did Gollum use it for? Stealing from people. Why? Because Gollum's a petty theft. That's it. But you go from Gollum to Vladimir Putin, and what would Putin use the ring for? I don't even want to consider the possibilities. Okay? Or Kim Jong Crazy, what would he use the ring for? He'd be raining nukes on the West Coast. Because he's crazy enough to do it. Okay? Gandalf, no, do not tempt me. Why? Because the way of the ring to my heart is by pity. Pity for weakness and the desire of strength to do good. Pity for weakness. He's not saying his own weakness. Pity for those who are weak. To do what? To help them, to defend them. And the desire to do good. Notice, Gandalf is saying, I could use the ring. I could try and do good. What might Tolkien be suggesting? If you think that the ring is merely a form of technology, maybe there are some technologies we shouldn't use. Maybe there are some things we shouldn't do, even out of a desire, what? To do good. We could stop and spend the whole rest of the semester and talk about some modern medical technologies. The kinds of stuff, some of which we learned from Nazi doctors. You know, they were trying to, quote unquote, do good. They were trying to perfect the human race. Okay, that means we have to rid it of Jews and blacks and gays and gypsies and Christians. And everybody who doesn't think and look like us, okay? The wish to wield it would be too great for my strength. What's Gandalf just told us about himself? He's not Albus Dumbledore. Because Albus Dumbledore wanted power. And it took a long time to realize. No, 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 I can't have power. Gandalf is saying, does he already have power? Oh, yeah. He's got lots of power. He's saying, with that, I would what? I would have power too great. I don't think there's any world leader today who thinks they could have power too great. You think Hillary Clinton thinks there's an idea of too much power for a president? Only if it's the other party in office. You think Donald Trump thinks that if he were elected president, he could have too much power? Nope. Putin? Kim Jong Crazy? No. The leader of the EU, which isn't really even a government per se, yet they're telling people, who owes taxes and who doesn't. Okay. But he does say we gotta do something and we have to do it soon. Okay? So Frodo says, I do want to save the Shire. I want to see the Shire saved. So Gandalf kind of says, if you're going to go, head to Rivendell. He doesn't say that's going to be the end point. But if you can, make for Rivendell. So Sam gets caught, and now we're going to skip a bunch. We get the three as company, and then the conspiracy unmasked when they get off to Buckleberry. Okay. And they decide to make their way to Rivendell. What do they do when they leave Crick Hollow, Frodo's new home in Buckleberry? Do they take the old road?
They decide to go through the forest.
What every husband slash father infamously says on a family trip. Look, a shortcut. And the wife says, honey, are you sure? And 12 hours later, what should have been a 6-hour ride, they take the old forest instead and get captured by Old Man Willow and rescued by Tom Bombadil. Okay. Who is Tom Bombadil? Why is Tom Bombadil not included in the film?
Excellent question. That's a great question.
Okay. Did you
have
your hand up?
It's actually never explained.
It's not ever explained in the novel, okay? But I think there might be clues.
He's kind of a guardian angel figure.
Kind of a guardian angel figure? That's a good question, whether or not he is a Valar. In the House of Tom Bombadil, page 131, Tom starts to sing to them. They've been there a few days, and he starts to sing or tell them stories. And they kind of drift in and out of consciousness. It's like he's just talking and they're surviving just on his words. Okay? And he's talking about the barrows and he's talking about Old Man Willow and all this other stuff. And Frodo finally says, who are you, Master? Eh? What? Don't you know my name yet? Obviously not, or I wouldn't have asked, but that's the only answer. Don't you know my name yet? That's the only answer. Frodo's probably sitting there going, I don't get it. Tell me, Tom says, who are you, alone, yourself, and nameless? Okay, when are you, this is my question to you, when are you alone, yourself, and nameless? Never, right? Because when you're born, what happens? Somebody names you. Okay. When are you alone? Are you alone if you're in your car by yourself? No, because there's people all around you. Are you alone if you're in your room by yourself? No, because you're in a room built by somebody else. So what does he mean? Who alone or only is alone something pronoun self and nameless? Nameless meaning not named by somebody else. When God sent Moses to the Egyptians, Moses was like, okay, but who am I supposed to say sent me? I got to get my name. Give me a card or something. I need proof. God said, tell them the I am. Okay, what does I am mean? I be. Okay? All of us can't say that. We don't just be. We come into being and we go out of being. See? This is independent. Why so? Because the rest of us are dependent. Okay? A pendant, some of you might be wearing one around your neck or something, means what? It's something like these. That hang. Okay? So to be dependent means you are out of or from hanging. That means there's something above. You gotta be hanging from something else, right? Or you're not gonna be hanging, you're gonna be falling. So to be independent means to not be hanging. It means to just be. Okay? Who are you yourself? Alone, nameless. But you are young and I am old. How old? Eldest. That's what I am. Mark my words, my friends. Tom was here before the river and the trees. Okay, what does he mean? Does he mean before the Withywindle and the Brandywine rivers? Before Old Man Willow? Yes, he does mean before that. But he means before
creation.
Any river in any trees. Hold on, hold on. When the Valar, when the Ainur came into Arda, okay, and became Valar, certain of them had specific skills, like the Greek and Roman gods. Okay? One of them was really good with growing things. Okay? And so when she gets to work, plants start to crop up and such. Tom might be suggesting I was here before that happened. But he goes back even farther than that. Tom remembers the first raindrop and the first acorn. He made paths before the big people and saw the little people arriving. The big people are men and elves. The little people are hobbits and dwarves. He's saying, I was here before they were. Okay, so we're going way back in time. He was here before the kings and the graves and the Barrowites. When the elves passed westward, Silmarillion story, Tom was here already, before the seas were bent. In the Silmarillion, when Arda is created and we get the stretch of the Middle Earth, the world that we inhabit is flat. Okay? So, Middle Earth is over here. You have an ocean. You have an island. You have an ocean. You have another world over here. This is Valinor. This is the world of the gods, the Valar. Okay? This is Middle Earth. This is the world of elves and men. And some of the elves get on a boat because some of the Valar come over to them and they bring them over and they let them live with the gods for a while and they become enlightened, as it were, illuminated, so to speak.
On the other side of them, the Valar is on that side.
Here? Nothing?
No, that's not.
Nothing?
So what's it called? Middle Earth? I've always wondered that.
It kind of comes to an end. I mean, what the description is actually, there's water flowing over the edge. Okay? So, he says, I was here already before the seas were bent. What he's talking about is after one of the big battles when Morgoth is defeated, Eru Iluvatar, through Manwë, takes this and turns it into a ball so that you can no longer get in a boat and sail to Valinor. You can't sail to the island of the gods anymore. Okay? I was here before the seas were bent. He knew the dark under the stars when it was fearless. Before the Dark Lord came from outside. Now, I think what he's talking about there is before Melkor leaves the presence of Eru Iluvatar and comes into Arda. Okay, so how could Tom be there before that? Because that was supposed to be the first. Yeah, that's my thought. I think Tom is a manifestation of Eru Iluvatar himself. Okay. I could be wrong. Tolkien never says. Tolkien actually says in one of his letters that Tom Bombadil is a manifestation or a spirit kind of suggesting pacifism. Pure pacifism. I'm not going to get any battles. I'm just going to sing songs. Sing the bad things away. La, 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 la. This bad stuff. Yeah, but Eru sang into being things, okay? So Frodo's kind of like, okay, man, you've been smoking something that we don't have down there in the Shire, so we'll just leave that. So they get captured by the Barrowite. Tom comes and rescues them. They go off to the Prancing Pony where they meet Strider, okay? Describe Strider. Rugged. What else?
Lanky.
Kind of lanky. Lanky. Okay. Impressive. What else?
Wise.
Mysterious. Dirty. Smelly. Foul. None of you use those terms.
Yeah, he almost came off as a bad guy at first.
He is dirty, smelly, and foul. Yeah. Handsome. Right. So they meet Strider, and Barnabas Barterber finally brings in a letter from Gandalf. And Gandalf says, you can trust this guy named Strider. He's a friend of mine. Make sure it's the real Strider. And he quotes a little bit of poetry. All the page 170. All that is gold does not glitter. Not all those who wander are lost. The old that is strong does not wither. Deep roots are not reached by the frost. From the ashes a fire shall be woken, a light from the shadow shall spring. Renewed shall be blade that was broken, the crownless again shall be king. Okay? How old is Strider? Older than Frodo. He's not 100-something yet.
He's
87. 87. So that when they meet Theoden later on in the next volume in the Two Towers, Aragorn, as Strider is more properly known, is going to say, I think he says this, I knew your father's father. Okay, now, Theoden is kind of old. Aragorn's saying, you're a young puppy to me. Okay, I knew your father's father. So if Theoden's like 45, and his father was 20 years older than him, and his father was 20 years older than him, that would still make them 2 years younger. That would have made Theoden's father's father 2 years younger than Aragorn is. Okay, he dies at about 185, 187, something like that. Okay, so the letter is read, and Sam kind of jumps up because Sam's Frodo's stout defender, and Sam says, you never mentioned Gandalf till this letter came out. You might be a play-acting spy, for all I can see, trying to get us to go with you. You might have done in the real Strider, took his clothes. Have you saved that? But you are a stout fellow. But I'm afraid my only answer to you, Sam Gamgee, is this. If I had killed the real Strider, I could kill you. And he stands up. And I should have killed you already without so much talk. If I was after the ring, notice he admits the ring, I could have it now. And he stands up, and he ought to be minimum 6'2". I think if he's 6'6", that'd be even better. And he ought to be somewhat birdy. I think Sam Elliott. Look up Sam Elliott, okay? Especially Sam Elliott about 10, 15 years ago, before his hair was all white, okay? Does a lot of Westerns, does a lot of soldier movies. He's this tall, lanky guy. He's got a pretty good southern Texas drawl and such. But he'd be ideal, okay? And the others kind of go, oh, sorry. But he says, I am the real Strider. Frodo then says, I thought you were a friend at the beginning, but, you know, I hoped you were. Because I kind of thought, you know, that one of his, Sauron spies, would, well, I don't know, seem fairer and feel fouler, if you understand. I thought one of his spies would appear nicer, and yet he'd kind of make my skin crawl. And Strider says, oh, okay, so I get it. So I seem fouler, but I feel fairer. Is that what you're getting at? In other words, you don't like the looks of me. Yes. This is why Viggo Mortensen isn't appropriate. He's too cotton-picking handsome. Okay? Yes.
Are we supposed to understand that? Live
longer
than
no. It's because of who he descends from. Because Aragorn is of the true line of Westernessa. Okay? Other men, same time period, other men die 60s, 70s, 80s. But because he comes from Westernessa, he comes from a family of long livers, so to speak. Okay? So would Boromir, if Boromir hadn't died. Boromir's line isn't as quote-unquote pure as Aragorn's, okay? Faramir will live longer than the average lifespan because he's also descended from Westernessa, okay? Yes, Seth?
Are they descended from Elrond's brother?
Elros? Yeah, I think that's it. There's a genealogy in the back, which you can look up. Yeah, I always get the genealogy mixed up. They're descended. Aragorn is descended. Well, yeah, this is a good time to mention it. They leave and they head off to Weathertop, an old watchtower. Right? And when they get to Weathertop, Sam starts to sing a little song about Elbereth and Gil-galad. Okay? They know the Black Riders are out. And we hear Sam sing on page 185. Gil-galad was an elven king. Of him the harper sadly sing. The last whose realm was fair and free between the mountains and the sea. His sword was long, his lance was keen, his shining helm afar was seen. The countless stars of heaven's field were mirrored in his silver shield. But long ago he rode away, and where he dwelleth none can say. For into darkness fell his star in Mordor, where the shadows are. Right? And Mary and others say, wow, don't stop, Sam. That's really cool. That's really beautiful. Aragorn says that's part of a much longer poem called The Fall of Gil-galad, which is included in the Silmarillion. I take that back. It's not included in the Silmarillion. So Tolkien's son will probably be publishing that at some point. It's not that I'm aware of. So they mention Mordor, and Strider says, don't mention the name with Black Riders around. And they determine that Gandalf had been at Weathertop. They see the Black Rider kind of coming. And Aragorn sings about 60 or 70 lines of a long song, okay, to them. And he says, you know, that this is appropriate, it's fitting, it has something to do with what we are doing. And he sings a song about Lúthien Tenúvial and Beren the Man. If you go to the cemetery, name just left my mind, in Oxford, where Tolkien is buried, you'll see on the tombstone, Edith Pratt Tolkien, it's Pratt, Lúthien, John Ronald Reuel Tolkien, Beren. He wrote the tale of Beren and Lúthien, which is one of the great love stories in the English language, about he and his wife. He met his wife when he was like 13 years old. Fell in love with her. The man who was raising him, because his parents died when he was young, a Catholic priest, forbid him to have any contact with her. Okay? Until he was of age, which was 21. And so he waited. And when he was 21, he got in touch with her. And they married, like, really quickly. I mean, their love was genuine and all that kind of stuff. Okay? So he creates this great love story, as it were, about them, that then becomes part of the kind of central mythology of the Lord of the Rings. So they, Aragorn tells this, and he tells them what kind of song it is, and he says, like all songs in Middle Earth, it is sad. Why? Well, what happens in pretty much all songs in Middle Earth? Everybody dies. See, there's in the tale of the Lord of the Rings, there is no quote-unquote Christian hope. There's nothing about, oh, but then we'll all be together again in the great, no. No. You die, and you go to the halls of your ancestors. That is the charnel house, where the bones are kept. That's it. There's no great heaven. Nothing like that is included. Okay, so when Tolkien says it's fundamentally religious and Catholic work, he means religious in sentiment and some of the ideas. He doesn't mean religious that at one point you're going to see somebody go, oh, praise Jesus. No, that would completely blow the work apart. Similarly, you don't have saints mentioned, you don't have Mary mentioned, you don't have God mentioned. The word God does not show up at all. You don't even really have, with one exception, any kind of religious ceremony or ritual. And the one exception is in the chapter called The Window on the West in the second book, the Two Towers, where Faramir and his men, before they eat, they stand, they look out this cave towards the setting sun, and they pause. That's it. Then they eat. It's a moment of silence, as it were. Okay? Long before there were moments of silence instead of prayers. So the black riders come. They tell Frodo to put on the ring. He puts on the ring. He sees them clearly. He gets stabbed. He stabs one of them. So now he's wounded. And we get the chapter, the flight to the ford. Okay? And they come up to and meet characters that Frodo met in The Hobbit. They come across Bert, Tom, and William. The three trolls that capture Bilbo in The Hobbit. Meanwhile, Frodo is succumbing to his wound. The wound that he stabbed with, what's called a mortal wound because of the valley where the sword was forged, piece of the sword has broken off in his arm and it's poisoned. Right? So he's falling under the spell of the man who wields that sword, who was what's called the Captain of the Nine. Right? He's called a variety of other things. He's also the Witch King of Angmar. Why is this important? Go back to Fog on the Barrow Downs for a moment. When Tom Bombadil rescues them from the Barrowite, he empties the barrow of all of its contents. A barrow is a mound, right? Looks like that. Go to Stonehenge. Take my class next time I offer my Harry Potter course in London. And take the field trip and go to Stonehenge. Look at the nice, pretty big rocks. They're pretty cool to look at. And then turn around and don't face the rocks. And walk in the circle around Stonehenge, looking away from Stonehenge. And almost 360 degrees around, you see barrows. These are burial mounds from roughly 3,000 to 1,500 BC. Okay? There are these barrows all over England. Many of them have been excavated, some have not. So, they come out of the barrow. Tom Bombadil then brings out of the barrow everything that's inside. Okay? Most of it's rusted and not any good anymore. But he does bring out some swords, or daggers, more appropriately called. And he tells them what the daggers were for. They were forged for the battles against the Witch King of Angmar. That is, they were forged, we're told, in Gondolin, an elf kingdom, okay, specifically to fight against him. They have spells woven in the steel. That is, spells were chanted while the steel is being hammered by the elvish blacksmith. Okay? They all get these swords. One of these swords is going to be pretty important when we get to the final volume, because it's going to be used to stab a certain person, okay? And it's going to be used to stab. It's going to be used by a certain person to stab a certain person, which I want to leave unsaid for right now, okay? So, as they make their way to the ford, they meet up with Glorfindel. Who is Glorfindel? He's the son of Elrond. What else? He's a powerful elf. Okay. And they get close to the ford and they hear the sounds of horses. The black riders behind him. Glorfindel puts Frodo on his horse, whose name is Aspidel or something like that. And he smacks the horse on the rear and he speaks to the horse in Elvish and he essentially says, "Ride like the wind, bullseye." And the horse takes Frodo across the Bruinna, which is this river. And Frodo turns around and faces the Black Riders. Turns around, stands up in his stirrup, holds up his little sword, and says, go back to the land of Mordor. This is page 214. Yeah, we've got a little over half an hour left, and we're halfway through the book. Go back to the land of Mordor, follow me no more. The riders halt for a moment. His enemies laugh at him, and they say, come back, to Mordor we will take you. Go back. And they cry, the ring, the ring. And then Frodo kind of plays his ace card, his trump. By Elbereth and Lúthien the Fair, Elbereth, the queen of the Valar. This is like, by Mother Mary and Joseph. By Elbereth and Lúthien the Fair. Why Lúthien? Because he's remembering the song that Aragorn sang. Right? You shall have neither the ring nor me. And the captain of the nine, the witch king of Angmar, the most powerful of the Nazgûl, okay, stands in his stirrups, raises his hand, Frodo's little sword shatters. His tongue cleaves to the roof of his mouth, and he's struck dumb. And at that moment, a big old flood comes down. And Frodo, just before he faints, sees a big flame come towards the riders and a bunch of little flames. Okay? And then we get to book two. Many meetings. Frodo wakes up. He's talking with Gandalf and such. And he says, what were those lights I saw? He says, you saw Glorfindel as he is on the other side. Whoa. On what other side? What does he mean, on the other side? As he would be in the land of the blessed. If I still had it up here, as he would be if he were still dwelling in Valinor. Elrond lived in Valinor for a while. Gives you an idea how old he is. He's really old. He's not as old as Galadriel. Galadriel has a good 1,000 years on him or so. Right? Galadriel is one of the second generation of elves. The first generation are the elves made by the Ainur in their singing, and their bodies are asleep on the earth. Ilúvatar awakens them. That's first generation. She's a descendant of one of those. Daughter, direct daughter of one of those. Elrond's a couple down from that, okay? So we have Frodo, you know, meets a variety of people. He sees Bilbo. How old is Bilbo at this point? This is 17 years later.
128.
He was 111 when he left. He's 128. Getting up there. So, meets a variety of people, and then we get the Council of Elrond, which I said was the second most crucial chapter. Notice how different this is than in the film. In the film, is it a council? What is it? It's a shouting match. Well, if you stupid elves hadn't done this, yeah, well, if you dumb dwarves hadn't done this, you know, Gimli's whipping out his axe. And complete nonsense. Okay? So we meet a few people. We meet Gimli. We meet his father, Glóin, who had accompanied Bilbo in The Hobbit. Okay? We meet Boromir. We meet a whole bunch of elves. And we see Strider in kind of a new light. And we have the Council of Elrond. So Elrond stands up, page 242, and says, welcome. You've done well to come. You'll hear today all that you need in order to understand the purposes of the enemy. There is naught that you can do other than to resist with hope or without it. But you do not stand alone. He's talking to the dwarves who say, we come because emissaries of Sauron have come and they're asking about the rings. Also asking about this guy named Baggins Hill. But you do not stand alone. You will learn that your trouble is but part of the trouble of all the Western world. The ring. What shall we do with the ring, the least of rings, the trifle that Sauron fancies? That is the doom that we must deem. That is the judgment that we must judge. That is the purpose for which you are called hither. Called, I say, though I have not called you to me, strangers from distant lands. So if they're called, but he didn't call them, who did the calling? The same person who meant for Frodo and Bilbo to have the ring. You have come and are here met in this very nick of time, by chance, as it may seem. Why does he say, as it may seem? Yeah. If I were to say Kim Kardashian seems like a wholesome woman, what does that actually mean? Is it true? No. I don't care what you think about Kim Kardashian, but the word wholesome cannot be used in the same sentence. Period. Okay? Seems indicates usually a condition contrary to fact. Okay? It's a subjunctive. So, by chance, as it may seem, Elrond is saying, this isn't chance, folks. You were each meant to be here. Yet it is not so. Believe rather that it is so ordered that we who sit here and none others must now find counsel for the peril of the world. So, Elrond speaks about Sauron, the rings of power, they're forging in the Second Age, and all that kind of stuff. And he talks about being there on the slopes of Mount Doom when Isildur cut the ring from Sauron's finger. And Frodo's like, whoa, 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 whoa. What do you mean you remember? I thought the fall of Gil-galad was a long time ago. He says, it was. My memory reaches back even to the elder days. In other words, I'm old, son. Bilbo over there, he thinks he's like two little butter spread over too much toast. Got nothing on me. Irindil was my sire, who was born in Gondolin before its fall. My mother was Elwing, daughter of Deor, son of Luthien of Doriath. So, notice. My mother was Elwing, daughter of Deor, son of Luthien. So, Beren and Luthien are his great-great-great-grandparents. This is why he's Elrond, half-elven. So he goes on and says, I was the herald of Gil-galad, marched with his host, blah, 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 blah. So Boromir says, all right, the ring. So what's become of the ring? Where's the ring? Elrond says, what happened to it? Isildur took it, blah, 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 blah. And then Boromir says, we men of Gondor, you know, we've been stout-hearted warriors, blah, blah, blah. We're defending you guys from the north. He talks about a vision he had. First came to his brother, then it came to him. He took the mission on himself to go down, or to go up, I should say, to go north. And he says, you know, we're not here seeking boon. We're just trying to figure out the solution to this riddle. And Aragorn stands up, page 246. It says, and here in the house of Elrond, more shall be made clear to you. He throws his sword on the table, but it's a sword in pieces. He says, here is the sword that was broken. It's still broken. Notice. Boromir, who are you? What do you have to do with Minas Tirith? Okay. Notice the difference between this and the film. Who comes to Aragorn's defense? Yeah, here, it's Elrond. You know, Mr. Smith, a.k.a. Elrond, in Agent Smith, a.k.a. Elrond, in The Lord of the Rings, doesn't have the kind of closeness to Aragorn that Elrond does here. He is Aragorn, son of Arathorn. He is descended through many fathers, from Isildur, Elendil's son. This is Elrond's way of saying, shut up and sit down, Boromir. You're talking to your future king. Okay. What does he mean, your future king? How long has there not been a king in Gondor? Well, yeah, I think so. if I remember right, it's something like 3,000 years. Okay, so real world parallel. A king that hasn't been a king in 3,000 years, that'd be 1,000 BC. We're talking pretty close. I don't know that Tolkien had this in mind, but I wouldn't be surprised. We're talking something like a descendant of David. Okay, so what is the Messiah supposed to be? The son of David. Okay? We like to think of another analog. Arthur. Works. It's just not 3,000 years ago. 1,500 years ago. See, the return of the king means when the king will reign again in Minas Tirith. They've not had a king reigning for approximately 3,000 years. Okay. England hasn't had a king since the mid-1940s. Queen Elizabeth became queen in 52, I think it was, maybe 51. Okay. But, Edward VII wasn't really a king. Not like this. He wasn't like Arthur, if Arthur was real. According to British mythology, when England has its greatest need again, Arthur will return. He'll come out of his deep sleep, and he'll return, and he'll make everything all right. Okay? Kind of the adopting this Christian idea and putting it on Native Germanic, Britonic kind of myth. Okay? So, Frodo says, oh, good, then it's yours, it's not mine. You take the ring. Okay, so Gandalf says, okay, Frodo, pull up, show him the ring. Let everybody see it. Frodo does this, he pulls the ring out and goes, look, I've got a ring, shining gold. I'm putting it away now. Isildur's Bane. All right? Notice, Aragorn then speaks to Boromir, page 248, and says, for my part, I forgive your doubt. Little do I resemble the figures of Elendil and Isildur as they stand carven in the majesty in the halls of Denethor. He says, I'm but the heir of Isildur, and not Isildur himself. In other words, a lot has happened in that time between Isildur and me. But he says, what else? Boromir's made a big deal about how far he traveled to get to this, to get to a Rivendell. Aragorn says, Boromir, dude, your travel is nothing. Turn to you got a bunch of maps in the back of your book. Yeah, this will work. You've got this map, which kind of shows most of Middle Earth. And Boromir says, oh, it was a hard, hard slog. Because I had to travel all the way from down here, okay, in Gondor, up to, trying to find, that's Lorien, up here to Rivendell. And that's a long distance, okay? Aragorn's like, dude, it's nothing. He says, I've been to the far portions of Rune over here beyond the Iron Hills. I've been to Far Harad. Okay, here's near Harad. So Far Harad's off the border. I've been throughout Eriador. In other words, I've walked all over Middle Earth. Don't be talking to me about how far you've walked to get here. Okay? Your journey is like a tricycle ride down the driveway, where I've been walking marathons. So, Bilbo gives his part, and then Gandalf gives his part. Right. Gandalf quotes the lines on the ring in the black tongue of Mordor, and the lights dim, and it's like there's a little mini earthquake, and everybody goes, ooh. And Elrond says, Gandalf, don't be using that language here. Gandalf says, let's hope none ever speak it here again. a little subtle warning. If we don't get our act together, that's the language that's going to be spoken everywhere. Okay? So what else? He talks about Gollum. He talks about what happened when he saw Saruman the White. Okay? What happened when he saw Saruman? Saruman took him captive. Okay? And offered him what?
Power and a partnership in the ring.
A timeshare with the ring. He says essentially, Gandalf, if you and I were to have the ring, you could have it 6 months of the year, and then I could have it 6 months of the year. Okay? And Gandalf's like, don't think that's how the ring works. Two fingers can't fit in the ring, you know. What else does Saruman offer? We could join with the power. We could join with Sauron and do what? What would be the purpose of that? He says, page 259, it would be wise. There is hope that way. Its victory is at hand. There will be rich reward. After all, what are we interested in, Gandalf? Knowledge, rule, order. That's the motto of Saruman. Knowledge, rule, order. If we align ourselves with Sauron, we can achieve those things. Yeah, I know a lot of bad stuff's going to happen first. But he says maybe after time we can turn Sauron into being not such a meanie. Okay? We can turn him into being a nice person. Gandalf's like, right. Look how well that's turned out with China. Most favored nation status. Look how well that's turned out with, you know, Obama's, let's say, opening up Cuba. Talk to dissidents in Cuba and find out how well it's been for them since we've restored diplomatic relations. Not so much. Okay? So, Saruman imprisons him, and Gandalf is rescued by Gwaihir the Windlord. So they find a chief of the eagles. So they finally come down to, okay, so this is the One Ring. What do we do with it?
And there's silence.
Why is there silence? You guys probably haven't had the joy yet of serving on committees where something has to be done and there's silence. Nobody says anything. Why? They don't want the responsibility because usually the first person who speaks, well, thank you very much for it. Okay? Open your mouth, stick your foot in it, kind of a thing. So they start to throw out possibilities. Here's what we can do. And one of them says, Bobadil, we should have invited him. Okay, were any of these people invited to this meeting?
No.
No, they just all showed up on their own. Tom Bombadil didn't show up on his own. He's not meant to be there. Gandalf says it wouldn't be a good idea to give it to him. Why? He'd regard it as a plaything. He'd be, skipping along in the forest, singing some stupid song, and he'd be playing with the ring, and he'd drop it and go, la, 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 la. The ring goes bye-bye, and he'd go bye-bye, and that'd be it, okay? Because what happened to the ring when Frodo gave it to Tom Bombadil?
He put it on his finger and he didn't disappear.
Put it on his ring and he didn't disappear. Frodo put it on his ringer and on his finger and what happened?
He disappeared. The ring didn't.
He disappeared and what did Tom Bombadil do? Whoa, ho there, stop now, Frodo boy.
He could see him.
He could see him. Elrond can't see anybody if they put the ring on and disappear. Gandalf can't see anybody. So why can Tom Bombadil? Well, Gandalf says such things have no hold on his mind. He would be most unsafe guardian. Glorfindel. Yeah, but he seems to have a power over it. Gandalf. No, don't think so. Okay, so what else can we do? Let's send it over to the ocean. To the Valar. It's not their responsibility. It's not their problem. They send it back. Let's throw it in the ocean. Get it down there, you know. Let's think of our ocean. Get it down there in the Marianas Trench, you know, good 12, 15,000 deep. Okay, that buys some time, Gandalf and others say. But what's going to happen eventually? It's going to find its way back. Okay. Gandalf says we have to find a solution for the problem of our time. Yes? We're not told exactly. Gandalf just says, he is his own master. Say rather that the ring has no power over him. He is his own master, but he cannot alter the ring itself, nor break its power over others. He is withdrawn into a little land within bounds that he has set, though none can see them, waiting perhaps for a change of days, and he will not step beyond them. Okay? Arestor says, would he not take the ring and keep it there forever harmless? Gandalf, no, not willingly. He might do so if all the free world or the free folk of the world begged him. He would not understand the need, and if he were given the ring, he would soon forget it or most likely throw it away. Okay? It's just that within Tom Bombadil's little realm, he's master. He's totally in control. To me, this either means he is like either manifestation of a real Luvatar, or maybe he is a manifestation of the spirit of the world somehow. Okay? But it doesn't control him. So, they can't give it to the gods. They can't give it to Tom Bombadil. They can't just throw it in the ocean. What other options do they have? Keep it. Keep it hidden. Don't use it. Okay. What does Boromir want to do? Use it. Look at this great fortune. We've got the one ring, the biggest gun, as it were, in the world, falls into our lap. And you're saying, don't use it? Come on, we should use it. And they all say, no, we can't do that. It belongs to Sauron, Elrond says, was made by him alone, and is altogether evil. Its strength is too great for anyone to wield at will. Okay. Final option? Destroy it. Unmake it. Well, how do you do that? You got to go into Sauron's backyard and throw it in his big fireplace. That's essentially it. You have to burn it. You have to melt it in the fire where it was forged. Page 269, Arestor says, well, that's the path of despair. Of folly, I would say, if the long wisdom of Elrond did not forbid it. Okay? Gandalf, despair or folly? It is not despair, for despair is only for those who see the end beyond all doubt. In other words, it's not despair. Despair says there is no possibility of success. There is no hope. Period. None. Okay. People full of true despair tend to commit suicide. They don't see anything good coming in the future. Okay? Folly? What's folly? Foolishness. Complete and utter foolishness. What is foolishness the opposite of? Wisdom. Prudence. Wisdom says do this. Folly says throw all care to the wind. Okay? So, Gandalf says, we do not see the end beyond all doubt. It's wisdom to recognize necessity when all other courses have been weighed, though as folly it may appear to those who cling to false hope. He's saying, this is wisdom. It's the only way. Can't give it to the gods. Can't give it to Tom Bombadil. Can't just throw it in the ocean. Can't just keep it secret and hidden. Why?
Someone will find it. Someone will break.
Someone will break. I mean, look at what it's already doing to Boromir. And he hasn't even touched it. He's seen it. He's heard about it. He wants it already. Okay? So any person, any country that has control of it It's going to sit there like a nuclear plant melting down, and it's just going to eat from within, okay, until somebody claims it. So, Gandalf says, Sauron will never expect this. Why? The only measure he knows is desire. Desire for power. And so he judges all hearts. Because what motivates him is desire for power. He assumes the same thing about everybody else. Sauron will think, if Gandalf the Grey comes in possession of the ring, he will use it. If Elrond comes in possession, he will use it. If Galadriel gets it, she will use it. If anybody with power gets it, they will claim it. Okay? He won't expect somebody to say, no, I don't really want it. I renounce this power. I renounce this ring. Okay? So if we seek this, we shall put him out of reckoning. That is, we will be beyond the capability of his thought. He'll never even consider the possibility. If he'll never even consider the possibility, what will he never do? Okay, what else? He'll never put a guard around Ordruin, Mount Doom. He'll never increase a guard into the back door, into Mordor. Okay? So, that's what they decided they have to do, and notice. So, who wants to take the ring to Sauron's backyard? Frodo finally says, I'll do it. I don't know the way. And what does Elrond say? If I understand aright all that I've heard, I think that this task is appointed for you, Frodo, and that if you do not find a way, no one will. This is the hour of the Shire folk when they arise from the quiet fields to shake the towers and councils of the great. It's not that been all trite crap that they have Galadriel essentially say in the film. Something about, oh, it's the time for the little people to rise and shake the great. It's not about little and great. It's about common, ordinary, everyday people. What is Tolkien saying? Ordinary people can do great things. We'll talk about it in terms of an election.
On the path, everybody has equal potential.
Yeah. One person can change the course of history. We don't tend to really believe that, do we? Adolf Hitler. One person. How about the group of persons who deny Hitler's application to the Art Academy?
Yeah, they were.
If he'd been accepted,
he probably
wouldn't have killed, 6 million Jews and caused the deaths of 60 million overall. Okay? One person, Joseph Stalin, killed more than Hitler did. One person, Pol Pot, one person, Mao Zedong, China. One person, my opinion, Fidel Castro. Maybe one person, your opinion, George Bush. Maybe one person, your opinion, Donald Trump. Mm-hmm. Hillary Clinton. Doesn't matter. One person. Look where Bill Clinton came from. Podunk Nowheresville, Arkansas. To a pretty poor family to become president of the United States, okay? Changing all history from that point on. Okay? So, this is the hour of the Shire folk when they arise from the quiet fields to shake the towers and councils of the great. Who of all the wise could have foreseen it? He says, but it's a heavy burden, and I'm not going to leave you on your own, Frodo. You don't have to go by yourself. Okay? So, the ring goes south, and Elrond names the fellowship. So we obviously have Frodo. And because we have Frodo, who else do we have?
Sam.
Sam, because, Sam even goes to secret meetings he's not invited to. He says, we're not going to sit up on shelf, are you, master? And he says, no. He says, I can't get rid of you. You got to go, too. Who else? Gandalf. Why? Okay, because he's Gandalf. And because he says, your task is still not complete. Okay. Who else? Leave Merry and Pippin to the end.
Aragorn.
Aragorn. Okay, because he's pretty much tied up with the whole ring thing. Aragorn's, we find out later, Aragorn's got other reasons for wanting the ring to be destroyed. He doesn't get to marry the woman he wants to marry until he's crowned King of Gondor. The woman he wants to marry is Elrond's daughter. Okay? So Elrond's kind of dangling the daughter, saying, nice son. King first, then wife. King, wife. King. Who else?
Legolas.
Legolas. Why Legolas?
He's one of the higher elves.
He's not one of the high elves. He's the wood elf. But he's going to represent elves. Okay. Gimli. Why?
Represents
the dwarves. Okay. Boromir. Why? Well, it's not because it represents human, because we got Aragorn there. Got the human quota filled. He's going that way anyway. He's got to head back down south.
Yeah.
I mean, they're in Detroit. They're heading down to Mobile. What a way to get there, right? So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Who does Elrond want to send? Mighty Elf Lord. Let's put Schwarzenegger in, you know, tights and everything.
Yeah.
Glorfindel. Okay. Merry and Pippin say, we're going. Hell or high water, we're going. Why does Elrond change his mind?
Gandalf.
Gandalf stands up for Merry and Pippin. Why does he do that? And before that, what does Elrond want to do with Merry and Pippin?
Send him as messengers.
Send them as messengers back to the Shire. Send them as messengers of what? Prepare. Get ready. Okay? He doesn't send them. They're not sent. That's why the scouring of the Shire happens. There is no warning given to the Shire. Okay? So, why does Gandalf say they should go? Using other terminology. Yeah, in the back.
We just talked about like how the small people can have the same chances.
Okay, but that's not what Gandalf says. The
small strength can't like carry you.
He says, in this matter, trust to friendship. Trust to friendship. He says, you know, the mightiest elf lord isn't going to help you get into Mordor. Okay. Trust to friendship. It's because of Gandalf that they are there. It's because of Pippin that what happens to Gandalf?
He falls into the pit.
Yes.
Okay, let's skip a whole bunch. Let's go to the Mines of Moria. Okay, they leave. They try to get over the mountain, Mount Caradhras. It won't let them, so they go to the Mines of Moria. Aragorn says, before they enter the mines, I say to you again, Gandalf, beware the Mines of Moria. Okay? Makes the others kind of go, I don't want to go in the Mines of Moria. Aragorn's afraid to go in there. But Frodo trusts Gandalf. As Aragorn trusts Gandalf. Okay? They go into the Mines of Moria. Who does want to go into the mines? Gimli, man. He's just itching and scratching to get into, because it's like the motherland. Okay? So they get to the Mines of Moria. They get to the big guard room. Completely different in the film than in the book. Okay? And in the guard room, there's a well. It's dark. They're all a little on nerve. How old is Pippin?
Like,
is he 33 yet? I don't think we're specifically told. I'm pretty sure he's still in his 20s. Okay. He's not Frodo's age. He's younger.
He
and Mary are both younger. Okay.
Is anyone Frodo's age?
Sam, I'm pretty sure it's about Frodo's age. So what does Pippin do? He sees, okay, I'm not going to assume this for the women, but I am going to assume this for the guys. How many of you, you find a big old well, you're not going to go find a rock and go, wonder how deep this is. Yeah, exactly. 1,001, 1,002, 1,105, 1,106. Okay, and then they hear, plop. Next time, throw yourself in, fool of a took, Gandalf says. Why? Because almost immediately after they hear the plop, they hear. That's not a natural sound. That sounds like drums. That sounds like something that should not have been woken up. Okay? And they're reading the Black Book of Mazapul, the journal or chronicle left behind by Balin. And they're reading it. And at one point he says, drums, drums. And at that point they hear, boom, 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 coming outside. Okay? And they're attacked. They flee from the guard room. They go all the way down to the bridge of Casa Doom, which is crossing, this is a bridge now, this big, huge chasm. Okay? You can only cross by single file. So they're making their way across, and the orcs all start to flee. And they're saying something, which they don't understand. The fellowship doesn't. And then Gandalf's like, oh, God, I can't hear this. Because when he blocked the door up here, he said there was something on the other side that put a counterspell, so I had to speak a word of command. And that kind of implies he spit, okay, whatever charge Maiar has, however they get it, okay? And so he comes out here, and now he's tired. So we have this little old stick figure Gandalf standing here, and he's got a big sword. Woo-hoo. And he meets the Balrog. Notice, Legolas immediately knows what the Balrog is. It's the worst thing in the elvish kind of imagination. It's their worst fear, their worst nightmare. It was Balrogs that helped destroy the High Kingdom of Gondolin, for example. Read in Silmarillion. So Gandalf tells the others, you go, I'll stand here. And what does he say? He says, you cannot pass. Notice, by the way, there are no mentions or examples of dwarf tossing anywhere. Page 330. Gandalf says, you cannot pass. I've had people tell me I should include that on my syllabus, you know. Cannot pass. The orc stood still, a dead silence fell, and Gandalf says, I am a servant of the secret fire, wielder of the flame of Aenor. Okay? The secret fire is not the same thing as the flame of Aenor. The flame of Aenor is the sword he carries. Glamdring. Where it says Orcrist. His is Glamdring, I think. Right? Thorin had Orcrist. Servant of the secret fire. That's talking about Eru and Luvatar. I think this is Gandalf saying, Maiar, go away. You cannot pass. The dark fire will not avail you. Flame of Udun. Go back to the shadow. You cannot pass. The Balrog jumps up onto the bridge itself. You cannot pass. Aragorn says he cannot stand alone, starts to run towards him. Gandalf lifts his staff, hits the bridge shatters. The Balrog falls, uses its whip, gets around Gandalf's leg, and then Gandalf falls. He cries, fly, you fools. And some idiot on the internet, I can't remember who this is, suggests that Gandalf doesn't mean fly as in flee. He means, fly, you fools. Leave the mines of Moria. Call up Gwaihir the Windlord. Get the eagles to come rescue you. Fly into Mordor and drop the ring off. That's what Tolkien really meant when Gandalf says fly. That's why you shouldn't trust what you read on the internet. Because that is completely ludicrous. Okay? So, Gandalf dies. Why? Because Pippin dropped a rock. And because Gandalf said, Pippin ought to come. Trust the friendship. Yeah, that's a good idea. Okay. But because Gandalf falls, something else happens. In the next book, but we can't go into it yet. So, Gandalf falls. They go off to Lothlorien. What's Lothlorien? It's another Elvish kingdom, but it's even better than Rivendell. It's like time doesn't even pass. And they're there for a month, actually. And when they leave, Galadriel gives each of them a gift. Okay? The gift fits the person that receives it. So, for example, she gives Boromir what? Big old massive gold belt. Like a WWE belt. Brilliant. Because he's a warrior. Okay? What does she give Aragorn? A sheath for his sword. Why? Because this is the sword that was broken. Any sword pulled out of this sheath will never break. That's a pretty good sheath to have. You want that scabbard for your sword. Okay? What does she give Legolas?
He gets a pendant.
Yeah, they all get a pendant. A little brooch to tie together their nice oak clothes.
She gives him some kind of a pendant and references Arwen.
The Elfstone.
Yeah, what's that?
The Elfstone. Okay? Because that's one of his names. Elfstone. Okay? Legolas.
It's the bonus made, though.
Yeah, and a quiver for his arrows. Okay? So he can kind of be like Hawkeye. The quiver never, he's always got arrows in it, as it were. Never understood that. What does Sam get? Two things. Dirt. He's a gardener. And rope. Sam's always wishing he had rope. They make him rope. Okay? What does Frodo get? He gets the Star of Galadriel, the little clear glass full of water from the Mirror of Galadriel. We'll talk about the mirror next week. We'll talk a little bit more about some of Fellowship on Thursday. Let's see. What did Merry and Pippin get? They get the brooches also. They get the things. They get the limbus. But there's nothing specific kind of for them. What does Gimli get? Initially, he gets nothing. And he's like, damn. Fucking hell. So she says, what would you ask for? He says, well, I mean, if I could, but I really wouldn't because they're all going to kill me as soon as I say it, but I'd take three of your hairs. What would you do with three of my hairs? That's kind of weird, man. And he says, I'd encase it in clear crystal, and it would be the greatest heirloom of my family. She's like, oh, Gimli, you're giving me the flowers. And she pulls off three hairs and gives them to her. Why? What has happened to Gimli in Lorien?
They
did blindfold him. They blindfolded all of them because, I mean, there's a dwarf. There are dwarves and elves, NAACP and the KKK getting ready for a Sunday picnic. They don't mix very well. Okay. We'll come back to this on Thursday before we get into the Two Towers. There's a couple other passages we still need to discuss. Thank you.